Hello everyone and welcome to the second lecture on arches of foot anatomy. If you missed the first lecture, then I have shared the link in the description and also here on the screen. In that lecture I have explained about every arch in detail, so please watch that lecture first. In this lecture I'll be talking about the factors which are responsible for maintaining the structure of arches and then the clinical anatomy. So let's get started. Now there are five main factors which help in maintaining the structure of arches. Factor number one is the shape of bones. Now due to certain peculiar shape of bones present in our feet, that helps in maintaining the different arches of foot, mainly the PTA, posterior transverse arch. Second point, intersegmental ties. As the name suggests, intersegmental ties means the structure which are helping to bind the different segments of the arch together. Point number three, tie beams. Tie beams, they keep the ends of arches pulled together and thus help in maintaining the concavity of the arch. Point number four is slings. Now we know there is a summit present in the arch. Summit is the highest point. Slings help to pull the summit up so that it maintains the structure. Point number five is suspension. Suspension helps in maintaining the overall structure of the arch. Now let us talk about all these five points in detail. Shape of bones. Now this point plays a very important role for posterior transverse arch. Now the formation and maintenance of posterior transverse arch depends upon tarsal bones and the base of metatarsal bones. Now these tarsal bones like cuneiform bone and the base of metatarsal bones are wedge shaped and they are pointed downwards. Now this peculiar shape of bones like cuneiform and the base of metatarsal bones help in maintaining the posterior transverse arch. Intersegmental ties, as the name suggests and as I told you before, they help in binding different segments of the arch together. Intersegmental ties. Okay, so in this case ligaments plays a very important role in binding the different bones of the arches together. So for medial longitudinal arch, here you can see in the diagram the spring ligament plays a very important role. As you can see, the spring ligament is helping to join various bones of the medial longitudinal arch together. For lateral longitudinal arch, the long and the short plantar ligaments, they help in binding different bones together for lateral longitudinal arch. And for transverse arch, there is no particular ligament, but it is due to the presence of various ligaments which help in maintaining the structure of anterior as well as posterior transverse arches. Now to prevent the flattening of arches and maintain the concavity, it is very important to pull the ends, to keep the ends pulled, and this is facilitated by the help of tie beams. Now for medial and lateral longitudinal arch, there are two structures which act as tie beams. First is the plantar aponeurosis and second are the muscles which are present in the first layer of sole. For transverse arches, adductor hallucis, this acts as tie beam. Now tie beams, as I said, they help in maintaining the concavity and prevent the flattening. Now to pull up the summit, slings are the structure that are responsible. For medial longitudinal arch, three tendons, the tendon of flexor digitorum, flexor hallucis longus and tibialis posterior, all together they pull the summit of the medial longitudinal arch. For lateral longitudinal arch, peroneus bruis and peroneus longus, they are responsible for maintaining the structure by pulling up the summit. And for transverse arches, peroneus longus and tibialis posterior, they run across the sole and they help in pulling up the summit of the transverse arches. Now suspension help in maintaining the overall structure, particularly only for the longitudinal arches. Now structure which act as suspension in the medial longitudinal arch is tibialis anterior, and the structure which act as suspension in the lateral longitudinal arch are the posterior longus muscle. Now talking about the clinical anatomy of the arches of foot. Now there can be two cases, either there would be absence of arches of foot or there would be overexpression of arches, exaggeration of arches. Now the absence of arches leads to flat foot, a condition which is known as pes planus, and the overexpression or the exaggeration of arches leads to a condition which is known as pes cavus. Okay, so let us talk about each one of them. In pes planus or flat foot, now there can be the compression of nerves and vessels. The foot will become more prone to trauma and osteoarthritis because of flat foot. And the biggest thing, as I told you in the functions, that arches help in the absorption of shock while running, walking, jumping. Now because of flat foot, this shock absorption won't occur efficiently. So these are the three main problems associated with the flat foot. Now for example, in case of flat foot, what happens is that there is the blockage of communication between the medial plantar nerve and the lateral plantar nerve, and because of this it leads to neuralgia, neuralgic pain. Okay, and then due to certain compression of vessels, it may lead to vascular disturbances of the foot. So pes planus is a very serious abnormality. Talking about the second condition, which was overexpression or exaggeration of arches of foot. Now this condition is known as pes cavus, and pes cavus occurs as a result of flexion, plantar flexion at the transverse tarsal joints. Okay, now a serious form of pes cavus, which is clawfoot, it occurs as a result of two things. It occurs as a result of dorsiflexion at the metatarsophalangeal joint, and then plantar flexion between the phalanges, the joint between the phalanges, that is interphalangeal joints. So clawfoot occurs as a result of dorsiflexion at metatarsopharyngeal joints and plantar flexion at the interphalangeal joints. Now there are two more conditions, telipes equinus and telipes calcaneus. Okay, so telipes equinus, in this the subject walks on the toes with the heel raised up. If you think of this as the foot, this as the toe, and this as the heel, so the subject walks on the toes with the heel raised up. And the second condition is telipes calcaneus. Here the subject walks on the heels with the toes raised up. So these are the two conditions which you need to keep in your mind. So if you are here right now watching me, thank you so much for watching till the end. I really, really appreciate that. Subscribe to our channel for more medical lectures and study tips. Hope you had a good time learning, and tell me in the comment section what you would like to see next. Thank you so much.